Well, good afternoon, everybody. I'm Chris Steinacher. I'm president and CEO of the St. Petersburg Area Chamber of Commerce. Very excited and honored to be part of this panel today and to help moderate it. I see so many friends in the room that could have done just as good a job or better than myself, so I certainly appreciate it. And to all my friends who organized this event, thank you for bringing your creativity to our community as well. And that's what we're going to be talking about, is actually why do events like this make a difference in your community and how do you foster them? So what I'm going to do is, rather than butcher every one of your names as well as what your background is, I'm going to ask every one of you all to reintroduce yourselves and just give us a sentence or two about your background in St. Pete.
My name is Walter Balzer. I'm the founding director of Open Learning at the University of South Florida, St. Petersburg. Open is the Open Partnership Education Network, and we had a soft launch last night and a wonderful event at Green Bench Brewery. We'll probably talk a little bit more about that, but I was born in Spain but moved to St. Pete as a kid in elementary school and have witnessed this amazing transformation firsthand. Thank you.
I'm Michael Vivio. I'm president of Cox Target Media, which is Valpak here in St. Pete. I'm also involved with the chamber, heading up the new Economic Development Council, or corporation, EDC, just launched, and we're focusing on capturing all this momentum that's happening in St. Pete and having a seat at the table as companies are making decisions about locating here and the rest of it. I moved here about 5 years ago from Austin, Texas, where experienced all that is South by Southwest, and I think Catlin underplayed it a little bit. It is consuming for the city, an amazing thing.
Hello, Mike. We on now? Okay. My name is Mark Ayling, and I am a sculptor, and I moved here 11 years ago from St. Louis and relocated my business down here. I'm also the president of the board of the Warehouse Arts District Association, an association that was started about 4 years ago, and we just recently purchased a piece of property through the 501c3 that is the association, and purchased the Arts Exchange, which is about 3 acres and 50,000 square feet to create some sustainability for the arts community. As the city of St. Petersburg continues to grow, we want to try and break this mold where artists get pushed out by their own success.
Hello everyone. I'm Steve Gianfilippo. I am the founder here at Station House, so welcome everybody. Mainly focus on boutique developments and lifestyle developments here in St. Petersburg. A few other areas outside of St. Petersburg, but it's really hard when people ask me what I do and where I develop. I say how can I not develop in St. Petersburg? There's just so much opportunity here, and the fact that we actually have someone here from South by Southwest is really, really, really a milestone for St. Petersburg. And I think we have to look at that and really embrace it. And I kind of see it as we have the opportunity today and this week to really look into the future, look to people who have done it and done it successfully for a really long time and accelerate that learning curve, because the best thing here in St. Pete is its diversity. And I think, you know, we're on the right track to keep building on that momentum. So.
Hi, Catlin Whittington.
You may have seen him here before.
Carney and stagehand.
My name is Leah Umberger. I'm one of the founders of Et Cultura. I actually grew up in Clearwater, St. Petersburg, coming here, and I actually left and moved back a few years ago. So it's nice to be back here and actually creating something of an event that I would love to attend. And I'm honored that you guys are here to share this with us. And I'm also honored to sort of have this conversation with people that a few months ago I would never imagine that I'd be sitting down with. So
great.
Thank you,
Leah. All right. So now you know we've got the right panel of folks, and we're going to, and please be ready to ask any questions, because this will be a conversation. But what I'm hoping we get out of this is, I believe if you live in St. Pete right now, you're probably having a wild love affair with St. Petersburg. I bet you every time you talk to somebody about St. Pete, the conversation either starts with or ends with, "I love St. Pete," or someone will say that, right? Okay, so can we get a round of applause? Anybody say, yeah, okay, so So who is this lover? Who is this St. Petersburg? And then who are you as the other lover in that relationship? And that's what we're going to explore is, what are we in love with? And if we have this passionate love affair right now, how do you make sure that continues on? What kind of care and feeding when you're in any kind of relationship with your spouse? You probably have some kind of arrangement with kind of going, okay, don't do that or do this, or a safe word or something, right? You know, everybody's got something going on to make sure that, and we're all going to learn your safe word so that it just, but what we're going to talk about is that love affair. How do we keep it going? How do we know when we're done? What are the boundaries of a love affair like this? Are there? And then how do we make sure that we continue to do wonderful things like this to attract it? And then will there be an actual payoff like a South by Southwest if we continue to have this love affair? Because I really believe South by Southwest really helped define Austin. I wonder if we would know as much about Austin if we didn't have South by Southwest, and we certainly can dive into that. But I just wonder if an Et Cultura or any of the other activities that many of you are engaged in can help us define that. So we're going to talk about how do events and activities define a community, and what would propel us, and do we want to be propelled? And those are all the kind of fair questions is, we like our funky St. Pete. What happens if it gets gridlock in traffic? What happens if we price everybody out? What happens if nobody wants to be here anymore? It happened before. Mike Vivio, I'm glad nobody here has been on the lived here for their whole life. I am going to do it. Mike Vivio hates when I talk about the old days. All right.
Actually, let me get that microphone out of his hand at this moment. You know what? When I moved here 5 years ago, there was this cultural thing that went on, and people would say, it started out sentences. I remember when St. Pete was. I remember when the Vinoy was closed. I remember when it was called God's Waiting Room. I remember when there was green benches. And so every time Chris starts a sentence like that, I grab the microphone. Because the fact is that the folks that are walking on Central Avenue and that are at Green Bench and tonight, and many of you, were born at a time when that was really irrelevant. And you came of age, and 20-somethings today came of age when they've never seen a St. Pete going anywhere but up. And as a community, it's okay to love this place and not remind and not dwell on the past. Now, obviously, it is part of our history, and obviously we want to learn from that. But it was such a phenomenon, even 5 years ago, more so than it is today. But how often have you heard sentences start out, I remember when St. Pete, you heard that one? Yeah, and there's too much of that, in my opinion. So,
right.
So stop.
All right, so let's cut his mic off if we can. No, I'm kidding. No, and that is what I want to talk about is because there are so many of you have redefined it. And so let's start with where we're at right now. We are in a place that actually, I'm not going to go back to my history of St. Pete, but I actually opened this. I was a branch, a bank marketing person, and I opened this as a bank a long time ago. And it was a bank back in the day, and it was just another piece of a wallpaper in this community. Steve, you have done something to this. What have you done here, and why are people in love with it? And what were you trying to do when you took this over?
Well, first of all, I have to say that. We talked about God's Waiting Room. We actually have God's Waiting Room downstairs. It's the name of our speakeasy. So, and we did that on purpose to just show everybody that it is not the, as it used to be called, the land of the nearly dead. It's more the land of the newlyweds and so many other things. So what we did here at Station House, and by the way, I was a customer of that bank, and I received loans and happened to over-lever on some of those loans. And being a developer, it's kind of what you do is over-lever. And that was back in 2006. So this building goes so far beyond that. It goes back to 1911. Originally, when I looked at the building, I thought it was going to be a hotel. I walked by it every day. I'm like, this would make such an amazing hotel. And so I asked a friend of mine if I could buy it and told him, it was falling apart and it was the doom and gloom story that I was doing him a favor to take this building away from him. So that's how it all started. But when I started to do some of the research is when I got really excited because this building took on so many forms over the course of history over the last 105 years. It actually was a hotel. It was a hotel a long time ago. And I would say the rates are a lot cheaper. So when you talk about inflation. Rooms here were $2.50 for the week. But it's took on many forms over the course of time, and I thought it was going to be a hotel. But then I started doing a lot of research, and you know, I moved to St. Petersburg in 2004. I actually repatriated back from Tokyo. I used to live in Tokyo, and worked for an investment bank there. And so, I came here and just like you said, Chris, just fell in love with the area. And you know, I think one of the things that just it was just this overwhelming force that we needed sort of an epicenter to celebrate St. Petersburg. And you talk about the rising prices of real estate and the rising prices of office space in general. And you have to keep the talent and diversity of St. Petersburg in place, and you can't lose that. And so we changed our business model. All my renderings and all my documentation and pitch books to get my investors to commit to this building were nice, fancy pictures of a hotel. So I kind of tricked them into making it what it is today, which is more co-work based. But really what we did here is I really just slice this building into five levels. And we have a restaurant and a speakeasy on the ground level. We have 2.5 to 3 floors of co-work space. We have the Iron Yard, which is a technology school that's on the floor above us. And really what we wanted to do is bring in all those really cool components of St. Petersburg under one roof, right? And we want to just epitomize what St. Petersburg is. And the greatest success for us is to really just turn it over to St. Petersburg so that they call it their own, right? And so we have artists and we have musicians and we have so many creative people here, but we also have the financial guys in this building. We have real estate. We have so many entrepreneurs. We have private equity funds that are in here, inventors. The list goes on and on. We have almost 200 different companies under this one roof. And so I think, there's always room for improvement, but what we've done is kind of set the stage for what we believe is kind of the epicenter where people can come together and have those collisions and meet other people. And that's the most important thing is to celebrate diversity. I think people have to get to know one another and they have to run into one another and they have to, their skills and their talents have to cross-pollinate. And I think that's what leads to the growth of this area.
Beautiful. Thanks, Steve. And I just want to, Alan Delisle, our City Administrator for Economic Development, has joined the panel as well. You heard how Austin works well with the city. Alan's here to promise everything to this festival and deliver it. So lock the door, if we can, behind me. Thank you, Alan, for your commitment. So that's going to be fun for us as well.
So I'm going to write Chris a check for that.
So you heard, you know, what I believe this is, as you heard at the very end of that, is a microcosm of what St. Pete is, which is allowing people to be seen, allowing people to be themselves, and allowing people inspire people just to come out and show the world what they have. And I think we're in a safe environment in St. Pete where we're seeing more of that, where people can be themselves and actually are inspired to do that. And a co-working shared space like this with a communal area provides that kind of space. And there's a few of them like that, but this is something pretty unique. So thank you for just kind of fostering that, because I think that is what we're doing here. And Leah, is that what this festival is trying to do as well? Or what are you trying to accomplish with that festival?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think there's four of us that are the founders of Et Cultura. I'm sure you guys may have heard Colin Lyman, Dave, and Joel, and myself. And all four of us sort of represented different areas of things that we were interested in the arts and different things that we were interested in St. Pete. And we just wanted a way to bring it all together. And the idea of getting people to come here and see St. Pete. I left here thinking, oh, I'm gonna move to New York, I'm gonna move to DC, because it wasn't good enough for me. But I realized that I love this city, so how do I make it what I want it to be? And that was why I really wanted to do this, and how do I bring the culture that I want people to see here? And how do I also show the people what the culture is that is in St. Pete now that wasn't here when I was a kid? And so to come back and see that was one of the things that really was like, yes, I will come in and do this with you guys and be a part of this. And that's sort of what it's grown from for all of us, I think.
Great, and thank you for doing that. And I really do mean it. When I saw the first video go up about what you guys are doing, we lobbed a call in to you guys because we were like, geez, please be successful, be wildly successful, because the more we can enhance each other's ability to pull these things off and really gather the right kind of people, the more that promise of St. Pete is going to pay itself off.
And I'd say that'd be the most surprising thing as artists that are working on doing this, is that you're not, as an artist, you're used to people saying no sometimes. And I think that one of the things that was the coolest is as we went out into the community, a lot of people said yes. And that's literally, like, Steve was one of the first. I remember I wrote him a letter earlier this week. I'm like, we sat in Green Bench on a closed Monday and talked about what this was. And he's like, yes, come use the space. And out of that grew what this is. And every meeting that we went and sat down into, people said yes. And that totally, like, I thought it was going to be the hardest uphill climb. And it freaked me out when it was easy. So I'll just say that. I was like, it's too good to be true. We said that so many times to ourselves. Like, is that did they really say yes? Okay. Then it was just that incubator in terms of keep going.
Caitlin, is Austin that same way? When you were trying to pull off the South by Southwest, did you feel that people were just saying yes? Was there pushes? No.
It was a lot more of the South. Austin used to be this, used to be that, and not really recognizing what it is now. We get that constantly to this day. And as an Austinite, so many of my friends have no idea what South by Southwest is about. Some of my friends from Austin. Hell, I didn't know what South by Southwest was about until they hired me and I showed up and I was like, wow, what is all this? This happens? But no, I think that there is some resistance, right? There's always concerns that it's going to change people's day-to-day ritual, change people's environment, their working environment, their community environment. Some people are really all about growth, and I'll say one thing for Austin is that we've had a very polemic community, citizenry over the years. In the 60s, there were two fields in Austin. Those that said, we want to do everything we can to keep Austin growing, and the other side said, we want to vote against any infrastructure that will allow for growth in Austin, and both sides got their way. And so we're kind of stuck in this position where we continue to grow without the support of infrastructure.
Yep. And that's not the good part of the story, right?
No.
Okay, good. And we don't want to get there either, so that's a good lesson learned. But it sounds like the natural culture of our community is an advantage right now. And I'd like to get into that natural culture a little. I do see Olga in the audience. Olga from Keep St. Pete Local, thank you for keeping that culture going too. I really do believe. I think we have a lot of those mechanisms in place, but Olga, you embody that for all of us as well, and allowing everybody to be themselves. And we say, you know, everybody can put their fingerprints on St. Pete, everybody can leave their footprints. We really believe everybody has that. What you're doing over at the university right now has a similar kind of open architecture for making sure people feel like the university is available to them. Tell people a little bit about the culture you're building.
Thanks, Chris. So at the University of South Florida, St. Petersburg, obviously you have an incredible institution. It's right there at the heart of downtown St. Petersburg. But it also represents a lot of what we see in institutions like higher ed or even medical institutions, you name it, and it's just very siloed. So a lot of stuff is happening, a lot of great intellectual, cultural engagements are there, but they're not connected. And so we see that across institutions and right here at the heart of downtown St. Petersburg. So what the challenge was and the vision of USF St. Petersburg was to break that down and to begin connecting learning and cultural experiences and take our intellectual engagements to the next level. And what do I mean by that? It's connecting what's already in this town and it's just siloed to the community, but also bringing in amazing thought leaders from around the world and making St. Pete a destination for that. So that's a tall order, but by its DNA from the beginning, OPEN, which is the program that I don't even like to use the word program. OPEN is the Open Partnership Education Network, and its DNA from the beginning was designed to be a collaborative and a think cooperative is the way that I talk about it. It was conceived with the ideas of Aspen and Aspen Institute and South by Southwest, and Catlin talked about how it's very disaggregated. South by Southwest is created by many organizations, by many different venues, And so Open is designed exactly the same way. So our events and our intellectual engagements are happening in the community, maybe on campus, but they're designed with open innovation in mind, just like Station House, just like the ideas that we're hearing today. It's the same philosophy that we get out of our silos and we begin connecting a lot better. And it's proven in other industries, and it was proven last night when we brought together all of the thought leaders in the urban agriculture space in 3 weeks. When you activate those networks and you bring intellectual engagements together like that, and then you have fun, that's what it's all about. And that's what Open is in a nutshell.
Beautiful. So you see, that's just like what OGA's trying to do, what the Chamber's trying to do, what the Station House is trying to do, is just allow everybody to play. And that is unusual. There are a lot of communities where there's a long line and it is a locked door and it is not accessible. So we could say that one of our advantages is the access we all have to every one of these things and getting a chance to know each other. And so in that mindset, Mike Vivio, you're leading an economic development effort and you run a large company that's going from a traditional manufacturing print background to an electronic foot background, major headquarters here in St. Petersburg. Competitive advantage for you guys? No? Do you see any reason for a company like yours or others to be attracted to that kind of environment?
Absolutely. You know, it's the economic development is years ago used to be about, you know, lots of land and build a factory and companies will come there. But today, it's about leveraging what you have as a community, and we have a tremendous asset here in St. Pete. We have this great sense of place that we all recognize, that we all feel, and that it is a magnet for people. In this part of Florida, it's unique, right? It's unique across the country, but it really is unique inside Florida. And having events like this, bringing the type of creative class, you heard in Catlin's talk, very specific mention to the creative class. And Austin has been focused on that for a generation because they know that creativity and entrepreneurship and those things about being out in front are, as a result, they're all the same skill, right? They're all the same skill, whether it's an artist or a programmer, it's about being out front. So as in building an economy around that is what Austin has done, because the many, many fabulous companies, I think Apple has their second largest population base outside of Silicon Valley, and every tech name is in Austin. But you know why it is? It's because the young, talented tech workers came for the music and came for the lifestyle. And that's what we have here in Austin. So as we unapologetically focus on the creative class and focus on things that make millennials, 20-somethings, I don't know how to describe this without sounding like the old guy. You know,
you are.
No kidding, yeah, thanks. To make the creative class happy, we'll build business. And I'll tell you why. And because a business like ours or another business needs people, right? And we know that millennials by practice will change jobs, right? They will change jobs throughout their career, and we will need to hire to replace. And so we need to be located in a place that attracts them, because it's a pool of who we hire from. That's why it makes economic development sense, and it's why St. Pete can compete with others who might have a larger population or more open land or more whatever. We have more of the talented folks, and we're attracting more of them every day.
Beautiful. So I think we just heard from the chairman of the new economic development effort that he's going to commit to us that creativity is, we're going to lead with that. We're going to lead with the funkiness of St. Pete, the entrepreneur stuff, and not worry about the other things happening. But if we focus on making this event successful, making this place successful,
that was the other thing Catlin mentioned. There will be in St. Pete, like there is and has been in Austin, a conflict between folks who don't get it Why is closing a street for an arts festival good for business? They, people have to walk further, they can't park. And it drives them nuts, right? Yeah, sure. And so old folks are gonna get angry, and young folks are gonna say, awesome, there's a great concert downtown. And that's great. And you know, and frankly, if you go to Austin and they're building a, you know, a 53-story condominium tower downtown, and you know what? That's not gonna be built. It's not going to be a 20-something musician who buys one of those million-dollar condos. Absolutely. It's going to be a 50-something who wants to be near all that energy.
Or a 30-something-year-old knowledge worker, right? And
yeah.
So I think that was kind of, Richard Florida wrote Rise of the Creative Class, but I think there's a misnomer in that, right? The creative class that he was writing about is this young, affluent knowledge worker, these high-paid individuals, but the creative class that we think about when we think about the creative industries of music and art, they are not this well paid, right? This is actually like a much lower socioeconomic class of creative people. So, I mean, I think there's a little bit of a misnomer in the creative class inherently in what the definition was when that piece was written that needs to be a little bit reconciled as we continue to have these conversations.
Yeah, fair enough. I guess what I wanted to say was that if we focus on the creative class in St. Pete, it is not at the exclusion of others, and it can't be at the exclusion of others. It's a fantastic tool and our best tool, given our sense of place, to lift all boats, in mm-hmm. my opinion.
Okay, sure. Great. So I think we've established that we know that we have a competitive advantage if we keep this up. Mark, I asked you to be on the panel because I was blown away with, we were at an event together and you were on a panel and you talked about the Flash. And it is something I've carried with me every day since then, and it's the one thing that at 3:30 in the morning I'm most concerned about. So first of all, tell people a little bit about yourself in the Warehouse District, but tell them about your concern about the Flash.
There's a great Greg Brown song, if anybody's familiar with Greg Brown. He talks about the boom town. It'll boom as long as the boom has room, is how the lyrics go. And St. Pete's a boomtown right now, and it's a boomtown for a variety of reasons. You know, some of it's luck, some of it's great planning. I mean, the city's got incredible bones. You know, the way that the founding fathers set up the city, it's a resort town on with the parks in the front and the main corridor. It's a beautifully designed city, and it's attracted a creative class for a variety of reasons. Bob Devin Jones, a good friend of mine, put it this way. He said that St. Petersburg has magic dirt. And you can interpret that however you'd like, but to me what that means is there's magic in the air. There's something about being here. I think the folks in the good old days said it was, you know, it's a peninsula on a peninsula. You know, it's surrounded by water, it's got good energy, whatever you want to call it. There's something here that attracts creative people. And there is a disproportionate number of creative people here. So what does that mean? We got this great creative class, and this model happens all over the place, and I talk about this when I talk about the Warehouse Arts District. Where the Warehouse Arts District is in an area of town that was born out of the light industry right off the train tracks, which is now the Pinellas Trail. You have warehouses there that have become abandoned because the role of cities has changed. Light industry has been transformed, the train tracks no longer function, turned into a trail, got all these warehouses that are empty. The artists move in there because they're inexpensive, it's a great big space, you can make stuff cheap. So their creative energy draws attention, that attention brings development drives up prices, the artists get pushed out. How do we prevent that from happening? How do we break that mold? So the question that we have before us is not how do we create a great community, but how do we sustain that community? I think great communities are created through that magic. There has to be that thing that makes them work. It has to come along organically. You can't impose that on a community. It won't thrive. In order for it to grow, all of the variables have to be right. But they have to be sustained then. So we're in a model right now where we've got this incredible growth rate. And not just people coming to town, but growth of cool things, growth of all things. How do we keep that from at least doing this and not doing this. Mm. And what we're trying to do in the Warehouse Arts District is focus on sustainability. The thing we have to look at is the things that will keep that creative class here and not have them get forced out. So then we start looking at government models. You know, how much do you want to intercede in that organic process, and what kind of caps do you want to put on things? Are you a conservative or are you a liberal? Where does the government's role come in all of this? Do you want sustainable housing stock? Do you want to keep housing affordable? Do you intentionally impose zones of affordability? These are the kind of questions that are in front of city planners right now, that are critical, because this young populace that is moving in here, and these millennials that we're talking about, they don't have a lot of money. They may be able to get a lot of money, and that's their goal, of course. I think we all, you know, want to be able to make more money, but the reality is their creative energy, we're going to lose that if we don't keep it sustainable. So you've got to start looking at what the specific variables are. You know, one of the biggest challenges that we have in the Warehouse Arts District, we sit right on the edge of the Midtown area, an area that has been run down, it's lacking resources, and it desperately needs redevelopment. Well, how does that redevelopment take place so that it doesn't cause gentrification and push out the people that are currently there? How can that area be brought up and bring those people up at the same time? And the root of that is education. You know, it's really interesting right now. We just went through an election that we could spend way too much time talking about. But the question of jobs is really critical here. And the nature of the job is changing, and it's becoming more more educationally based. And creativity is going to play a huge role in that. So combining creative people with tech people is like, there's future in that. You know, creative problem solving is the future. Learning technology, learning how to apply information, that's where the future of jobs is. You know, that's how you can bring those people up. And I'm getting in the weeds, so I'm going to back off.
No, that's good, though. But I think anybody concerned about just the sustainability, anybody getting priced out, anyone, yeah, absolutely, right? So that is something we have to pay attention to. I know when I read, and this is what you got to be careful what you read. So I read in the newspaper, you know, the discussion about Janus Landing and maybe not staying open. Man, I'll chain myself to it before they do anything with that, right? But we've got to put some stakes in the ground, right? We have to say what's important to us and how do we communicate that. So thank you, Mark, for discussing the Flash. Alan, we didn't get a chance to introduce Alan Delisle as our city administrator. He has been here almost 2 years. He comes from great markets like the Durham Market, where we just came back from, and he showed us how they looked at redevelopment and sustainability issues. How do you respond to Mark when you talk about sustainability of economic development and the price points, and what can government do and not do, in your opinion, about the Flash?
Thanks, Chris. I was hoping that you were going to totally go on to a different subject, but honestly, I'm only kidding. It is the heart of the issue. I've been in the middle of it my whole career, and it's very interesting, and let me just kind of lay out a couple of issues and then try to answer the question from my perspective. You know, a lot of cities across the country would die for what St. Petersburg has in its downtown, right? They would kill for it. They would kill for the residential development that is occurring. Most don't have it and are dying to get it, and they're working hard to figure out how to get it. Now, we can talk about price point, and we should. But what has been accomplished here to a large extent over many years has created this unbelievable heartbeat in downtown that's driving the economy today in St. Pete. And it is, when I say driving the economy, it allows most of us to flourish. Now, the one thing that Chris mentioned Durham, the one thing that was very unique about Durham is Durham had a creative class. In fact, we did a study based on the work that was mentioned that Dr. Florida did. We used his firm, and we did an analysis of Durham. And for our size, we were the number one ranked creative class city in the country at the time. We based our whole economic agenda around that when we had Raleigh next to us that was just the opposite. And we knew that that was going to be our niche, and it was, and it is. Now, we also had something called the Research Park there. We had high-end research, universities, and we had job growth beyond belief. And so between kind of the placemaking strategy that we had for the creative class and the economic development strategy that we had around cluster economic development, which is exactly what the new EDC is doing, that's being led by Mike and Chris, we put a very diverse economy together that drove large business and small business. I hate to get into an argument about which is better, because let's face it, a lot of small businesses exist because of the large businesses, right? They create work for small businesses. And so, you know, it's, for me, it's not an either or. It is a balance. When you get into issues of gentrification, that's when it becomes the most difficult to deal with from a city perspective. Mm-hmm. I think it was mentioned, you know, I mean, I've been in four different cities now. Every one of them has kind of your ingrained thinking and your up-and-coming thinking. And those, at times, will clash. But what I do, what we try to do from an economic development perspective is we look at the assets in both, right? Because there's the ability to create jobs within both categories, right? There's a lot of people that have been in this community a long time and are still doing fantastic things. And we, as a city, want to support that because it means more job growth for residents who come here. But it's kind of like the internet, right? I mean, the internet took us all from a world that was like this, from a communication standpoint, to a world like this, right? Yeah. Economic development works best if we've got a world like this. Mm-hmm. And that's what we're talking about today. It's a world like this. That means all of you, as Chris said, are playing in this economy as well, right? But it doesn't work. It doesn't work unless you've got a lot of different assets within the community. I mean, it doesn't work in and of itself for somebody to create a wonderful place where people want to be without a strong job base to go with it. So to me, it's growing your small business base. It's growing your entrepreneurs. It's nurturing your medium-sized companies, but yeah, it's also working with your large companies, you know, to keep them here, keep them growing, and hopefully spinning off development. And gentrification, I will just say this, it's a very delicate matter. One of the things that we just did with the Commerce Park, we've got 14 acres on the east side of Durham, east side of St. Pete, back in my old city, sorry. And what we did is basically we gave an incentive to the businesses that are going to operate there. If they hire residents from the neighborhood, then they get a reduction on the cost of the price of the land. So there are ways of doing this. What's a shame is if, in my humble opinion, what's a shame is that if municipalities are not creative enough to create, and it's hard work, man, let me tell you, it's hard work. When you get into that workforce development piece, that's not easy. Now, these jobs are attainable for a lot of people who live in the CRA, right? These aren't like high-end jobs. It's actually a marina-based cluster of businesses. So what a great opportunity. We got 100, 200 jobs that are going to be created there over the next couple of years. And what if, you know, 75% of those jobs are taken by CRA residents, people who live in that community, and get that paycheck and spend money there? I bet you it's going to help the Warehouse Arts District a lot, and others. So to me, it's, you know, looking for those strategic ways of for the public sector, right? I mean, a lot of people say, get out of the way. I agree with that to a certain extent. But there are areas where the public sector can only get in there and create a spark or an incentive to make the local piece work better.
Perfect.
I just want to jump in there because we're jumping back and forth between a couple concepts, right? You have one, the character of the development, right? Not wanting to change the character of what makes St. Pete unique, right? And keep the old buildings and then you have the concept of gentrification, pricing out the very people who give it the character. And then you have the concept of economic development and spreading that, maybe wealth isn't the right word, but spreading that development out. You know, a mile from here, we have failing schools. We have a place where young families want to move to, and if they have houses that they can live in and will rehab and turn around neighborhoods, that's the key to having those schools improve also. So there are many things that are great about this, and gentrification is leaping to the pricing people out, but there's also a lift that happens that if we are cognizant at this stage of our growth of not messing up the character, not pricing out the exact people who built this place, we are able to spread. And then, you know, there's so much happening on the south side right now because of the university and the hospital. And, you know, those houses on the south side look just like the more expensive ones in the northeast. And people are remodeling those, and those neighborhoods are becoming strong again, and Kenwood becoming strong. And that's going to lift those schools because the people who will buy those will be the type to demand great schools. They will demand it, and they are wired to live in an urban environment. They're wired for public schools, and for us as a community is to be ready for them.
Beautiful, great.
We'll say that, you know, gentrification isn't necessarily a bad word. The connotation that it's always used in is pricing, right, and affordability, which is, it's a market response to property taxes. Unless people are actively selling, if your property taxes don't go up, you're not priced out, right? Well, you could get priced out of renting. So a lot of times what we've been seeing in Austin, what people have been trying to focus on in Austin is pass towards ownership for creative arts, for musicians, for music venues. How do we get them in a position of ownership so that they are not stuck on the receiving end of rising rent rolls and they only have to worry about rising property taxes? And how do you have a policy that can stabilize those property taxes for musicians and those in the creative arts? I would like to say that, you know, there's a weird phenomena in Austin right now, and it's kind of a reverse anchor that creates kind of a natural market stabilization. And that's a cluster of homeless resource centers right in our downtown entertainment districts. And before there were a bunch of people living in downtown Austin, the community was trying to figure out where to put homeless resource centers. There was nobody living in downtown Austin to cry NIMBY, and so they said, well, we'll just put it right in the middle of downtown. Well, now everybody lives in downtown Austin, and there's this eyesore. But that's the only reason that these music venues that are all around it can still exist, is because they've got this homeless shelter as a neighbor that's keeping their property values affordable, because nobody wants to move in there yet until they move it. If it moves, those music venues are gone, unless there's something that comes in to artificially stabilize the market.
And that just sent a chill to everybody. If the Music City loses the music, what do you have? And
what do you have, Blake?
What we're trying to figure out too is what do we have and what are we going to protect to make sure we don't lose it? So I really do believe, Mark, your theory is something that should be on all of our minds as we go forward in this as well.
Well, the challenge with that is, you know, we're imposing a variable in the Arts Exchange. That project is trying to break the mold, and the way we're doing that is we're using a 501c3 to get donations and grants to develop the property, so we don't have return on investment. The Salt Creek had about 50 artists in it just down the road. It closed down for various reasons. Real cheap rent for artists. The person who ran it loved the arts, but they didn't have enough money to keep the building up because the rents were so cheap. They lost the building, was torn down. That group of artists wanted to relocate, and I watched them We tried to recruit them into the Warehouse Arts District, big group of artists, and they formed a tight coalition. They worked with a developer and a real estate person, and for 2 years, they tried to get a model put together in a building in the Warehouse Arts District and in that part of town, and it failed over and over and over again because they were looking at a traditional investment model, and anybody with money wanted a certain return rate for their investment, and the artists could not afford to pay studio prices for that ROI, which is how we came up with the idea of using the 501c3 to fund the Arts Exchange so that we could break that mold. But in a traditional investment environment, the folks that are in the creative class, they can't afford to pay those rates. So either as a community, we start giving more money to the creative class, or we have to find ways to keep them here. They're going to get pushed out. And in Pinellas, we have, I mean, this is the most developed county in the state of Florida. So there's nowhere to go here other than out, away. I mean, we will lose the creative class if we don't pay attention to this issue.
Got it. Beautiful. And so it sounds like we need to be as creative in keeping them as they are in being creative, right? So, and Alan, I do want to make sure it goes on. That was a very creative response. And that Commerce Park, if you don't know, is right next to Mark's project as well. And so that is a city that gets that and says, hey, we're going to, if you, we'll keep you down, we'll keep it low if you do some things. So you city up for other ideas like that?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, you know, I definitely agree with what everybody is saying. It is a very important policy issue that we have to deal with both on the housing side and on the commercial side. You know, what is happening and what generally happens, and it's happened elsewhere, is, you know, the further you go out from downtown, the price point starts to come down. And so, you know, we've seen that, right? We've seen, you know, Central Avenue with its activity there, and the Warehouse Arts District even further out. The city is moving west and south within that context. The price points are lower than downtown, but they're increasing. And when we get to the point where the Trop is redeveloped, let's hope someday soon, and the Rays stay there, you know, there will be a large development there in the middle of our downtown that will push even more energy that way. Skyway Marina, everybody laughed at us a year ago. You know, oh yeah, you're gonna get something done down there. Well, in today's paper, or yesterday's paper, big article about the first developer that's doing a mixed-use project down there, and the price point is going to be lower than downtown, right? What people don't know is there's two other developers behind that that are ready to go down there as well. So we're going to see more and more investment and development outside of downtown as time goes on. The city, we are always open, and we are, you know, so the city owns some property, right? This is where a city can play. The city owns the Trop, for example. We own where the old police, where the current police station is. We own that. We own some land in front of the Trop parking lot right now. We own land throughout the city, and we own the Commerce Park. And we were able to use the fact that developers were interested in doing something on that land and use that as a negotiating tool to get the price point reduced on projects. That's one way, that's one significant way that we can do it. The public sector can always step in and try to change the direction of policy, bring down a price point within development to make it happen, and we're always keeping our eye open for that, and we've got several examples of that in the works as we speak. In terms of keeping St. Pete where it is. The mayor is very concerned about Central Avenue, for example, right? We've got a number of local retailers that are located there, and as time goes on, the concern is that they will get priced out. And we've got an initiative that we're working on right now that we think will help. It's a tool. you know, putting more and more tools on the table to help with that. We've done the commercial revitalization program, which several entities just applied for and got it, which is a local match of up to $100,000 for neighborhood development projects with key goals and objectives. Not huge money, but it's something that says, hey, we'd like to help make this happen in a distressed neighborhood, but we're also looking for a particular outcome.
Beautiful. So you do see, you know, we do have, you know, what I want to make sure people understand is we have a competitive advantage. Most cities don't own a lot of land. That's very unusual. And then you hear about the city, I forget what it's across the bay. What is that? Tampa, that's it. I hear about them, and they've got 35 acres, and they're having a love affair with that. You just talked about 85 acres there. You talked about 25 near the pier area. You talked about 12 at the Commerce, the Skyway. There is a lot of story to be told here. If we can keep guys like Alan understanding this economic development proposition about what we're trying to do here, I really do believe that's why these conversations matter, is because we have a golden opportunity that a lot of cities, like Alan said, would love to have what he's got the ability to do. And they're all healthy properties that are throwing out tax money that continues to allow him to invest in these ideas. So what I want you to make sure you do is write down his name, and he'll give you his email at the end. Work him. And I mean that.
Chris Steinacher.
I mean that because I've seen Alan to be very creative in listening and making sure that people are heard. So what I want to make sure is our city's accessible, our university's accessible, our arts district is accessible, we have accessible space here, and now we have an event that's instilling that. So, holy cow, guys, you know, maybe that is why we're having a love affair.
Hey, Chris, can I circle back to the university?
Yep, please.
I want to tee you up here for a second. You know, the university is growing from where it is about 6,000 students now to 10,000 students, and you can see what's happening there. I had a privilege of going to see the University of North Carolina, UNC. They have built this great model of partnership between businesses and the university, and they built a campus called Centennial Campus, and students graduate having worked with actual businesses, and then actual businesses come onto campus to work with students. Fantastic model, great model. When I left there, I was struck with one thing. They built a fake city. They built a fake city to put businesses and students together. And we have that here, right? And that's what you're building.
You're right. And interestingly, it's funny that you mentioned that example, because my specific research and my work when I was at Boston University is on blended capital partnerships and learning. And that goes from the top down, because something we haven't talked about here is the K-12 schools. If you really want to attract the top talent in the world and keep that talent here, it's about those schools. And that's probably the one Achilles heel that we have, all right? When you win a Pulitzer Prize for how bad the schools are, that's not a good thing, all right? And I'm just cutting right to the chase on that. So it's from the top down, from higher ed all the way down, making those connections. And in my research, I spent 4 years working on this, and always, every single day, it was St. Petersburg on my mind. And it was not a coincidence that my work went in that direction, because A, I have a love and passion for the city. I grew up right here, right next to Mirror Lake, and I feel like that's the missing piece. I've always felt that. So it was about that. And it didn't take very long in the research to realize that exactly what you're saying is the resources are right there, and we're just scratching the surface, barely scratching the surface. Whether you're talking about undergraduates or graduates that are not necessarily connecting what they're doing to the community and vice versa, or all the way down to a fourth grader, it's so isolated and so disconnected, and that is something we can overcome. And so that's really what we're trying to do. The philosophy is first. We have to establish an open philosophy, and that's really a common denominator amongst us all here, is we're saying this is about opening it up to new ideas, new institutions, big, small, open that up. But think now, is that happening in the schools? It's not. It's just not. So it's a great point.
Beautiful. Good. So I think I'm about at a point where I'm going to start opening it up for Q&A. I do want to clean up a few. You mentioned you're a 501c3 that takes donations.
Yes.
Every one of these people want to donate. Tell them what to do.
You can go online to whereartismade.com. And if you click on the donate button, then the website will guide you through the process. And you can also become a member of the Warehouse Arts District. You don't have to be an artist, and you don't have to be in the district to be a member of the association. We have a variety of levels of membership, and we would love to have your support.
Okay, so do me a favor, do something for that, because if we really do care, you're hearing about a piece of it that really needs the love and the love and care of everybody. So don't be unabashed. Get on that site and do what you can. And then, Steve, after hearing all this conversation, you're one of the guys that we want to keep close, because you're one of those crazy developers that's willing to go get a loan, put some money down, do more in a community. So we want to inspire folks who are willing to be crazy enough to develop things. Does this give you good feeling? Are we on the right track? I mean, as a developer, as an investor in what you're up to, do you need to hear something else about St. Pete to make sure you do the next investment?
No, I think we're on the right track. And I think, you know, one of the biggest things is that, and you and I were talking about this earlier, is that the risk profile has changed since, you know, graduating college. And before it was just, you know, you graduate college, you get a, you know, you have good grades, you present your resume, and you go work, and you kind of get in that pecking order. And the world's changed. It really has. And whether you're part of a nonprofit or a for-profit, we all take a lot of risk. And we take a lot of risk with organizing these grand events and the energy it takes. And time is risk, and time is energy. And, you know, the most encouraging thing, I'll probably go back to an example, you know, speaking about another event that was held recently here in St. Petersburg, which was the Wine and Food Festival. And I think it's maybe 2 years old now.
Yep.
Maybe 2 years is the second year?
Second year.
And I remember the first year, and you know, we have retail businesses inside of the building with the restaurant downstairs. And you know, just going through the sponsorship process and thinking about it, there's always that uncertainty in your mind of things, you know, kind of getting off on the right foot and succeeding, because you think about St. Petersburg, there's so many events here, so many things to do, and you're just like, wow, one more event, is it going to make it? I remember walking by the event this year, and it just had exploded from the year before. And those are the things that keep giving me energy, are seeing things like that being adapted by the community, and the energy that people put into it, and the risk that they take to get those events all off the ground. You know, kind of brings me back to this event, and you know, you can't, you know, the saying, I think, from the song is you can't have the fire without the spark. And so you have to think of this event as the spark to what's yet to come when we talk about this event. And so I think those are the things that encourage me to keep developing here. I think, you know, as we encourage here at Station House, strength, we have strength in numbers, right? We all have to lend our part together, and Station House isn't successful without having anchor tenants in the building to help subsidize the revenue to bring in the affordable space to have memberships here and to have office suites, you know. And so we have memberships for the students as low as $25 a month, and I always tell everyone, you have a 30,000 square foot office being inside this building, but we can't get it done without having risk takers inside our building, risk takers in our anchor, in our core tenants, and risk takers all around us. And so I kind of applaud the community for that, and we see it every day. We see people taking risk, and you know, development for me, it sounds risky to the public, but then you know, you draw things on paper and you say, okay, if we do this, we could, you know, make this much money, and there's a defined exit or outcome. A lot of the people that we see inside the building, they're from creative backgrounds, and they're developing apps, and they're, you know, Tom Waters has 2 U.S. patents on the digital autograph. He's right in that office down there. No, some people don't even know he's there. And so I really have an appreciation for the diversity of the community and the backgrounds. And so it's very encouraging to me to see these events just keep coming to St. Pete. And sometimes I find doubt in them. I'm like, how can we sustain one more event, and then one nails it, and then that, you know, helps me move on.
Beautiful way, because I'm going to have Leah have the last word before I go to the Q&A. So Leah and I and Joel got together about
don't know, a week ago or ago, and if you've ever done an event, about a week before the event, you freak out. Everything, you have the deer in the headlights look. Nothing is right yet. Everything's a concern. Oh my God! Oh my God! And Joel came in and he was different. He literally was a different guy than when I met him the first day. He announced this thing. And I was like, what the hell's going on with him, man? And he was like, hey, man, we got to get this done. We don't have time. Next year, we got to hit. I'm like, dude, why did you do this? Is it for the, you didn't do it for the money. And he was so concerned about the sponsors and the money and everything. And I like, man, it sucked the life out of the guy. And I felt so bad for him. I gave him a counseling session, man. And but then I said, why are you doing this? Why did you guys sit around, drink a beer, and do this? Leah, remind people exactly why we're doing this anyway.
That's why I'm talking about why we're doing it. No, good, we're good. No, I mean, I think that we genuinely wanted to highlight what's going on here, and that's why we're doing it. You guys are all talking about keeping the artist here and what's going on. And we want to make sure that the artists have a place, and it does here. And one of the things we want to do is just keep highlighting that and working with everyone that's here. Like, that's been the best part about it, is working with the community. And what you're saying, like, I'm learning from just being on this panel, and we'll be a better organization because of that. And I think that the more that the organizations can engage with the city and engage with the people that are in it, that's what makes the city grow and become stronger. And so I think that the chance to be able to talk to everyone here and have a platform is what we're trying to create, but the chance that the city has is to get, we need guidance, you know, and I think that that's the biggest thing for us, is that we're new and we're fledgling and this is the new thing for us, and I think that's what we're looking for next for us, and to keep growing.
Yep. Yeah. And what I just said to him, just be yourselves, because that's what St. Pete, that's what the promise of St. Pete is, and if we start worrying about the economic impact of the event, we lose focus. The economic impact will come if you're authentic to yourself. And so I think that's where we're at. That's the kind of love affair we want to make sure we have, is the authentic love affair with each other.